So normally we talk a lot about Starship, but let's try this one also talk about some other fascinating developments in space and spaceflight. Because as always, there's so much happening again. SpaceX has test-fired a Falcon 9 rocket at Cape Canaveral in preparation for the space station resupply mission for the 4th of December. Then we'd also like to talk about a company called Nanoracks that has a highly interesting idea for building space stations, and also wants to test that method on a Falcon 9 rideshare mission. Meanwhile, Boeing has joined their CST-100 Starliner capsule to the Atlas V rocket, which will be launched on the 17th of December to the ISS as the first uncrewed test flight.
And as if not enough was already happening in December, the Long March 5, China's most powerful rocket, will blast off in mid to late December, carrying a communication satellite into orbit. But there's more to this story than only a communication satellite. And then a bit about Mars, because we all love Mars, right? So of course we want to talk a bit about the 2020 Mars rover mission that will actually search for past Martian life. Then we're shown a fascinating weather simulation of Mars by NASA's Ames Research Center. And lastly, a crazy professor goes full berserk and sees bugs on Mars. And then we want to talk about a new study that suggests that we might all be aliens. That's right, we all might be aliens. Okay, I give up. I will never have the cool hairstyle like the alien guy. So stay tuned for these fascinating but also partly weird news.
So last week on Tuesday, we could witness the test firing of a Falcon 9 rocket at Cape Canaveral's Launch Complex 40 in preparation for the December 4 cargo resupply mission CRS-19 to the ISS with its trusted Cargo Dragon spacecraft. Now, interestingly, it's the same Cargo Dragon capsule that already flew on the 4th and the 11th resupply missions. But more interesting than this is the company Nanoracks' upcoming mission in late 2020 with the Falcon 9 ride-sharing. For those of you who don't know, SpaceX introduced a rideshare program a few months ago to further reduce launch costs for small payloads by simultaneously launching many smaller satellites or experiments along with larger payloads.
So on that rideshare mission, Nanoracks wants to use a robotic arm developed by Maxar Technologies and apply a process called friction milling in order to cut metal in such a way so that no space debris is created in that process. So what might sound a bit boring and technical at first is actually freaking cool, because they want to further develop this technology in order to build space stations later on. But not just normal space stations like the ISS, but they actually want to use space debris from upper stages of rockets that are currently circling the Earth as space debris in order to transform that space debris into space stations. Because we all know that space debris really is a very big and serious problem for spaceflight. And what's better than to turn the space debris into space stations? So that's why we are really excited about this mission, and that's why we hope to see it succeed in late 2020.
Over at Boeing, the Starliner CST-100 capsule has been attached to the Atlas V rocket that will carry the capsule to the ISS on the 17th of December as the first ever uncrewed test flight. Yes, we know, we often like to call out Boeing for their corrupt behavior and greedy business practice. But this time, we actually would be very happy to see this mission succeed, because an additional option to get to the ISS is not so bad. Even though, of course, SpaceX has already done an uncrewed test flight with their Crew Dragon capsule half a year ago. It will be interesting to see who will reach the ISS first with crewed flights. But SpaceX seems to be leading here, and we estimate that we will see the first crewed flights with the Crew Dragon capsule at the latest by mid-2020, when exactly Boeing will reach the milestone to carry astronauts to the ISS remains to be seen, but probably also sometime in 2020. Too bad though that they almost got twice the money that SpaceX has received to achieve the same goal.
Now, meanwhile in China, preparations are underway to launch China's most powerful rocket, the Long March 5, in mid to late December. This flight will carry a communication satellite to orbit, which at first sounds really boring, but it will actually also serve as a test flight for the mission in 2020 that will send China's first unmanned probe to Mars, complete with a lander and a rover. We've already talked a bit about that mission in one of our last videos here, but this will be China's first interplanetary mission ever. Now, the Long March 5 has a LEO capacity of 25 metric tons, putting it into the same league as an Atlas V, Delta IV Heavy or Ariane 5. But of course, it's not in the same league as Falcon Heavy, because Falcon Heavy can carry almost 3 times more payload to low Earth orbit. A lunar sample return mission, the Chang'e 5 mission, which is planned for the next few years, will also be carried to the moon on this rocket. That's why a successful flight for the Long March 5 is so important for China. And of course, also in light of the future, because they want to perform an uncrewed test flight of China's new spacecraft in early to mid-2020. Of course, also with the Long March 5.
This new spacecraft, which hasn't been named yet, will be capable of venturing beyond low Earth orbit and carrying 4 to 6 astronauts beyond LEO. So make no mistake, what we see here is the prototype of the spacecraft that will carry Chinese taikonauts to the moon. It's an open secret that China has plans to carry out crewed missions and land people on the moon in the 2030s, complete with building lunar bases with a special focus on mining lunar resources. China thinks very long term, and they probably already know that the moon will become very important in the mid-21st century as a crucial source for resources, with giant reserves of helium-3, which can then power helium-3 fusion reactors. And who controls helium-3 will have vast amounts of energy at its disposal.
Now, we would be a bit worried that this might lead to an imbalance of powers on the moon if we were to fully rely only on NASA. But luckily, we have these guys here who are working on this so-called moon lander, as it funnily is called in this official NASA press release. This little moon lander will fortunately land quite a few years before China and will then be chartered by many nations in the 2020s in order to build an international moon base where many nations will be able to collaborate on the moon. At least that's what we hope will happen. That's why we don't have to fear that a single nation will dominate the moon, in our opinion. And it's of course all thanks to this guy here. And certainly not thanks to this guy here. Or this one. Or this one. And now finally to Mars, our favorite planet in the solar system, after Earth of course, because we like Earth kind of quite a lot. It's a neat little planet with nice lakes and plants and also funny looking animals. For example, this race of ape creatures is quite funny, we have to say. We like them sometimes. I mean, sometimes. Sometimes also not so much. No, sometimes, no, don't like them so much.
But yeah, back to Mars. So last week, a fascinating animation has been released by NASA's Ames Research Center, showing the evolution of clouds on Mars over an entire day-night cycle. It's so fascinating to watch what a dynamic atmosphere Mars has, despite the atmosphere being so much thinner than here on Earth, at only maximum 1% of Earth's atmosphere pressure at the surface. But that's already enough for dynamic cloud formation, as we can see here. These clouds, by the way, consist of water ice, not carbon dioxide, which makes all this even more exciting. Future astronauts will certainly be able to witness many fascinating weather phenomena, such as blue sunsets and sunrises, dust devils, glowing high-altitude clouds, among other extraordinary phenomena.
Then the 2020 Mars rover, which is actually quite identical to the 2012 Curiosity rover, which by the way still roams around on Mars and makes quite amazing photos and discoveries. Now this rover has the necessary science equipment to actually search for past Martian life. For example, for fossilized remains of ancient Mars life. It will carry out its mission in the Jezero crater, which is also thought to have once harbored a giant lake a few billion years ago, exactly like Gale crater. This was actually an ancient delta, an ancient riverbed, and we know that Mars harbored liquid water for more than 1 billion years, maybe up to 2 billion years, as newer research shows. So there actually might have been enough time for simple organisms to develop, and those fossilized remains might be found by the 2020 Mars rover. Fascinatingly, it will be the first time that a drone will fly on another world. Yes, that's right, the 2020 Mars rover will carry a drone with it that will be able to fly around a bit and test the technology for later drones, which will then fly on Mars for quite long distances. So we're really excited for this mission because, you know, possible ancient Mars fossils and a flying drone? I mean, that's freaking awesome. And what's even cooler, you can still fly drones on Mars without being arrested. Let's see how long that will last.
Speaking of Mars, a funny professor named William Rommoser.
Wherefore return?
Against the clear warnings of this gentleman here that specifically warned us now to go.
Full return. You went full return, man. Never go full return.
But the professor chose to ignore these warnings and thus made this drawing here, claiming to have spotted bug-like creatures on Mars. Okay, we shouldn't be too harsh on him. He's a professor emeritus, meaning a retired professor at Ohio University who has studied entomology, so insects his entire life. This, however, is a fascinating case study of pareidolia, the phenomenon that the human mind sees familiar shapes, such as faces, animals, or other stuffs, on rocks or in clouds and so on. Our brains are hardwired to that by millions of years of evolution.
Speaking of millions of years of evolution, ladies and gentlemen, a new study has found that we actually all might be aliens. No, I will not do the hair stuff again. Now, a new study published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences of the United States of America found evidence for ribose sugar in extraterrestrial meteorites. Now, why is that so fascinating? Because the precursor of all our DNA, and by the way, all life on Earth is based on DNA, is RNA, and that is ribonucleic acid. So the precursors of those ribonucleic acids, which are the precursors of DNA, are found on freaking meteorites drifting in space through the solar system and probably throughout the galaxy and the universe. So it's very likely that the building blocks of life already developed in space even before Earth existed, and were then carried to Earth and other planets, such as Mars, but of course also exoplanets in other star systems, by bombardment with meteorites. Now, this is highly mind-blowing because this would mean several things.
First, life is extremely common everywhere because the building blocks are spread throughout the universe in countless meteorites. Second, the rare Earth theory is a stupid theory, as we ourselves have long suspected, because life immediately started on Earth, when the conditions on Earth were still brutally life-unfriendly. So this is a very important finding, showing us just how common life is in the universe. Oh yeah, and it's probably also based on a quite similar chemistry.
What? So that's some freaking amazing news that the precursor to RNA was found in meteorites. Like, how awesome is that?
So we are all aliens or what?
Yes, yes, confirmed. Aliens. That's why my head is also has such a weird shape.
And what do you think about the Chinese? When do you think they will be able to land the first people on the moon?
Probably around 2030 earliest. But SpaceX probably will be faster. And space stations built from space debris? This idea is genius, right?
So be sure to tell us your thoughts in the comment section, because we will try our best to reply to everyone. We are even taking shifts for that, right?
Yes, and it takes quite some time to reply.
And we would be very happy if you would subscribe to our channel.
Absolutely. If not, she might get angry and turn into Hulk again.
See you next time.
See you.